Welcome back to Analysis. This week marks the 96th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration. The declaration, which was released to the Times newspaper in November 1917, stated that the British government would support the creation of a home for Jewish people in Palestine following the end of the First World War, when the lands were ceded from the Ottoman Empire. The letter, which was attributed to the then Foreign Secretary, Arthur James Balfour, stated, "His Majesty's government view with favour the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people and will use their best endeavours to facilitate the achievement of this object. It being clearly understood that nothing shall be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine or the rights and political status enjoyed by Jews in any other country." Well, today the declaration is seen by many Palestinians as a symbol of the British government's historical support for the State of Israel and the Israeli government, and their weakness in rebuffing reports of human rights abuses by Israel in the region. And as next year sees the marking of the 100th anniversary of the First World War, is it time for the British government to reassess the historical impact of that Balfour Declaration? Would a formal apology for the declaration even help the current situation in the region? Well, joining me to discuss this is David Steele, Lord Steele of Akewood, former leader of the Liberal Party, who has visited and written about the region numerous times, Nassim Ahmed, senior researcher at the Palestinian Return Centre, and Mark MacDonald, the founder of Labour Friends of Palestine. Well, let me come to you first of all, Lord Steele. I mean, do you think it was a terrible mistake, that declaration?
No, I don't think it was. If you read the thing correctly, and you were quite right to stress the sentence, but this is the sentence that people forget. It being clearly understood that nothing should be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine. The truth is that has never been followed. That's the mistake. The other reference, of course, was to a national home. He didn't say a state. So that even the Balfour Declaration, and my Palestinian friends are always reminding me it was a Liberal government that issued this letter. But I say, yeah, but people have not stuck by the letter of the letter. That's my complaint.
But wasn't it Britain sitting on both sides of the fence simultaneously?
Oh, probably, yes. I mean, you have to remember the context in which issues in Palestine were undergoing at the time. And it was in the middle of the First World War, so it wasn't a happy episode. But nonetheless, I still maintain that provided the letter of the letter was followed, there wouldn't be the problems we have today.
Well, Nassim Ahmed, what's your view? Do you think Britain should even apologise for this declaration?
We have a 5-year campaign to galvanise interest and support for Britain to actually apologise for the Balfour Declaration. But the Balfour Declaration is not just the declaration itself. You have to understand this is 28 years of British policy. The declaration was a pillar of British policy within the mandate period. And as Lord Steele said, by the letter of the law, if it was stuck to it, nothing should have been done to actually prejudice the rights of the indigenous Palestinian community there. But I think the conclusion has been that what was the Jewish community got more than what they were promised, far more than what they were promised, and the Palestinians received far, far less than what they were entitled to. And that's the real issue here. We can get into the discussion about whether Britain had a right to include the Balfour Declaration within its mandate or not. That's a different discussion. But ultimately, the result has been I would disagree with Lord Steele on that issue. I think there was intentional ambiguity within the declaration itself. I think the idea of a Jewish community is, I think, for the Jewish people within Palestine, they meant a Jewish state. They wanted a Jewish state. And I think Britain could get away with saying simply a Jewish community. But that was interpreted differently by different people. And the Palestinians have always been with the line that we are the indigenous community of Palestine. Like all the other countries around us, we want our own self-determination. We want our majority rule and democracy within our country. But for some reason, because of that promise made by Britain, there was reluctance to actually allow Palestinians to actually flourish as a political community because of the, irreconcilable promises. Because there's no way you could reconcile the notion that there will be a Jewish community, a Jewish state, and not cause harm to the Palestinian rights and Palestinian self-determination. There was irreconcilable promises
there. Well, let me just ask Mark about that. I mean, you set up the Labour Friends of Palestine, presumably because you think the bias of British policy has gone too far in one direction. Was there any way that it could have been reconciled, that you could have both communities living there in some sort of harmony?
Well, of course, and it's possible now, and one always hopes that Israel will accept and treat their Palestinian neighbours with the respect and compliance of international law. So, yes, of course, it's always possible. But I think what we need to bring ourselves back to is the declaration itself and the context to which it was written. You see, at the time, there was a large immigration problem, so the government was concerned about, in relation to a large Jewish migration to this country, immigration to this country. And as a result of that, and it was only as a result of that, Balfour came out with this, in essence, to deal with the 250,000 Jews that were living in this country and to prevent more from coming into this country. And arguably, and many scholars and historians have argued, that actually Balfour's motivation behind this was not to be the great man of the Jewish people, and indeed, as seen today within Israel, his names are on streets in Tel Aviv. He wasn't a great man of the Jewish people. Many historians have looked upon him as seen it as an anti-Semitic declaration, a way of attempting to prevent and to get rid of the Jews that were living in the United Kingdom.
But of course, he wanted people, or there was an idea that they would go to Uganda, first of all.
Well, that was before. That was a sort of a Zionist, the National Zionist Community's discussion in relation to a land in Uganda. He moved on from that and chose Palestine and looked at Palestine. But it is important to see why this declaration was made and look at it within the context of the time, and to see with it not as to be the great man of the Jewish community, as I say, but as is somebody who's trying to deal with an immigration problem in the United Kingdom.
Well, let me come to
you wrote the letter to Lord Rothschild. So, I mean, it's an interesting hypothesis. I don't know. I mean, I genuinely do not know whether it's justified to say that was the main motivation. But I think it was probably a contributing factor. I put it no higher than that.
But what about after the Second World War, and then the Liberals weren't in government then, so you're clear on that. Wasn't the bigger mistake, you know, the partition of Palestine and the British running away from the mandate and creating basically two states?
Did they run away from the mandate? They were forced away from the mandate by the Israeli terror groups. I mean, that we have to remember that as well. So it wasn't entirely an orderly, peaceful withdrawal. It was pretty rough.
No, but if they'd held on and got the UN to try and set up, if not Britain, peacekeeping forces of some kind to try and prevent the war that then emerged.
Yes, that's going back to what might have been, and I
right.
agree with you, that would have been a better solution.
Right.
But coming back to today, my gripe is that every time you criticise the Israeli government, which I do a lot, you get accused of being anti-Israel, or worse, being anti-Semitic, which is complete nonsense. Mm. And I think we need to get a dialogue in this country, not so much on the history, but on the current situation, to say, look, it is just not tenable that we allow a friendly allied state, a democracy, Israel, to flout international law all the time on things like the resettlement of people, forced resettlement of people, the route of the wall, has been condemned in the international court and by the Israeli Supreme Court. Still, they go ahead. The settlements, I mean, the case goes on. The treatment of children, Arab children, against the Geneva Convention, which Israel is a contributor.
Well, and yet the EU is softening all the time, is giving Israel association agreements and all the rest of it, aren't they?
Well, exactly. And my own view has been that the European Union should be doing far more to put pressure on the Israeli government by reviewing the association agreement. How can you have an association agreement with a state, with a government, which is constantly flouting international law? And I think that goes against the ethos of the EU.
Now, you've compared the way Israeli government people treat the Palestinians with South Africa under apartheid.
Yes, I was heavily involved in the anti-apartheid struggle, and I do see parallels. The Group Areas Act in South Africa is very similar to what happens to the Palestinians. The separate roads that they have, Israeli citizens only, in the West Bank, One could go on. I mean, there are quite a lot of parallels with the South African state. They don't like that being mentioned, but it's true.
No, I think when President Jimmy Carter, after retiring, used that phrase, he was heavily pillaged.
I met Jimmy Carter recently. He was doing a session at Chatham House, and he was being very optimistic about the current state of negotiations. Let's all be optimistic about the current state of negotiations. It's more in hope than in expectation, but at least there is a big effort being made to keep the two-track solution on.
Well, Nassim, what do you
think?
The
biggest parallel with apartheid, of course, is the Bantustan element of the Palestinian territory, the dividing up into little self-contained sectors, which is what the South Africans tried to do with the Bantustans.
Well, Nassim, how optimistic are you about these current negotiations going on with John Kerry and so on?
I'm not too optimistic, but I want to pick up on something which Mark said, which is, again, regarding the Balfour Declaration. I think it served two purposes. I mean, first, within the context of the time itself, there was a sense within a lot of European governments, including Britain, that they would need to enlist Jewish support for the First World War. And the reason they made the declaration was to actually preempt a German declaration for a Jewish support for a Jewish homeland. So that's, if you go to the historical sources, that's one of the reasons why Britain actually came forward first and made that declaration. So the American Jewish community would actually pressure and lobby the American government to come on the side of Britain, and also create a pressure within the Bolshevik new Russian government to actually come on the side of Britain and fight on the side of Britain during First World War. So there's that element. But the declaration itself, after it became British policy during the mandate, that's when it went wrong. It became wrong within the implementation of the declaration itself. And up until 1948, people think Palestinians left were ethnically cleansed as a result of the 1948 war. But half the Palestinians actually fled, 400,000 Palestinians had actually fled even during the time of the British mandate. So as a protector, the British government actually failed to protect the Palestinian community.
They fled because of Israeli Jewish pressure Jewish settlers.
That's right, Jewish pressure because of Jewish settlers. So 400,000 Palestinians had actually fled before the war actually started in 1948. 200 Palestinian villages were actually depopulated. So the ethnic cleansing had actually started way before the 1948 war. And that is one of the reasons why our organization says, no, Britain failed to protect the Palestinian community. It failed in its mandate. And like it did with the Mau Mau, it needs to come and apologize, recognize that it failed, and recognize that it did great damage, especially during its suppression of the 1936-1939 revolt, where nearly 10% of Palestinians were either exiled or imprisoned or killed. So 10%. So Palestine, after British mandate, were almost a rudderless community without any leaders. It took them nearly two decades to actually come on the political stage again. So Britain actually did a lot of damage because of its policy, part of which, as I said, is the Balfour Declaration. And that's why Palestinians around the world believe that they need to apologize, to recognize, and they need to apologize, like it did with the Mau Mau case and various other incidences during its colonial period. So that's our position, it's our view in this.
Well, let me move back to you, Mark. I mean, the history is very well explained just now, but what about the present and particularly the future? I mean, do you see any hope in these negotiations, or how can pressure be put on Israel to make real concessions, genuine concessions?
The one thing we saw from the WikiLeaks and the papers that came out from that in relation to negotiations that had been going on in the last decade or so is that Palestine, through its representatives, had actually given up a lot and given up a lot in negotiations. And the more they gave up, the more Israel wanted to take more and more and more. And my only concern is when it comes to there's so much pressure now, not necessarily upon Israel, but pressure upon the Palestinian leaders, that how much are they going to give up? How much of, when it comes to settlements, when it comes to the right of Palestinians to return back to their homeland, is going to be given up in relation to some peace agreement? And then when it's taken back to the people of Palestine, will they be happy with it? So, yes, what may take place in Washington, and we all want peace. We all want peace. But we want peace on the right terms for the Palestinian people. We want peace that is going to be recognised. Now, after Oslo, we thought that there was going to be peace. We thought there was going to be movement. But incrementally, it has either been ignored or it's been overridden by Israeli policy that has continuously, as Lord Steele has said, flouted international law when it comes to human rights for the people of Palestine. So, yes, we can have a document. What's that document worth to the people of Palestine? I don't know. But more importantly, are Israel going to abide by it? Because they never abided by Oslo.
Well, one of the problems, of course, is there's Palestinian disunity between Fatah and Hamas, and there is allegedly a unity agreement, but it never gets implemented. So some of the fault is on the Palestinian side, isn't it?
A bit, but I think that's often used as an excuse. I mean, we were the people who were supposed to be championing elections. Elections took place, Hamas did extremely well, and then we said, oh dear, this is terrible. You know, we can't have our cake and eat it. If you believe in democracy, you've got to... And my experience of the Palestinian Authority, colleagues may disagree, but I thought Yasser Arafat, whom I got to know quite well, was a brilliant liberation leader, but an absolutely hopeless administrator of the administration. And it's not surprising that they lost the election. So I don't think we should fasten on to divisions within the Palestinian community as being a reason for not encouraging the peace process. And I agree with Mark, it's got to be peace with justice, not just peace, not just a bit of paper. And that's why I don't think any Palestinian leader can possibly settle for the sort of Bantustanization of the Palestinian state. It's got to be a proper state.
But do you think it ultimately depends on the United States? I mean, we talked about EU.
Unfortunately, yes, it does largely depend on the United States.
You know, at the beginning, people thought Obama was going to be different from previous presidents.
And I must admit, I was one of those as well. I was there at Obama's coronation in Denver when he was selected as the candidate. We thought this was the beginning. And it's been a bit disappointing, I have to say. But I don't think we should just blame the United States. I come back to my point that I think we in Europe also have a responsibility. And I think the European Union has been terribly feeble in continuing to engage in gracious, good association trade terms with the State of Israel and not demanding that a condition of that is the implementation of international law.
The one thing the European Union has done recently with the Horizon funding, that's a massive amount of money, billions of pounds, they have said that we are not going to give any money to any Israeli company that deals with settlements. And that's caused an enormous amount of problems in Israel because, you know, there's a number of manufacturing companies that are going to lose out, a number of universities that are going to lose out on funding. So I agree with what Lord Steele's saying about the European Union. But they are actually seeing the issues and the problems and are moving in the right direction. I think what's happened in the last 5 or so years is that people have become much more engaged with the issues of Palestine, much more wanting to know what they can do about it. And they've latched onto Horizon funding, this multi-billion pound grant that have been going out, and they're not going to Israel. And that's caused an enormous amount of upset within Israel.
Tell me about the Labour Friends of Israel and the Labour government. I mean,
yes.
I think Gordon Brown was a big mover and shaker in the Labour Friends of Israel, wasn't he? Ed Miliband is not, as far as I understand. I mean, do you see a real difference on their policy towards Israel from this, you know, leadership from the previous one, Blair and Brown?
I think when it comes to historically with Labour Friends of Israel and its influence within the party, it has been in the past quite a strong influence. But I think what was needed was to have some sort of counterweight within the Labour Party and to get the message out about Palestine and what was going on in Palestine, but to do it in such a way that, you know, it was understandable and moderate, and we can say that we can move forward in the right direction on the issues. And what Labour Friends of Palestine has been able to do is do exactly that. We have now become the largest and most effective organisation within the Labour movement on Palestine. We provided a counterweight, and this brings us back to Ed Miliband. Because of that, Ed Miliband has been able to come out and discuss and be able to formulate policies, foreign policies on the Middle East, the classic one being the recognition of the state of Palestine, by a Labour leader hadn't been done before. If he had been in the United Nations, if we had been in government when the vote had taken place, the United Kingdom would have supported the recognition of the state of Palestine. And that, I say, is down to the influence of organisations like ourselves, which has been able to influence, really, and provide that counterweight within British politics.
Well, we're getting a little bit towards the end of time, but let me ask you about sanctions. I mean, sanctions are one of the things that really helped to bring down apartheid. Are you in favour of sanctions on Israel?
Well, I think I come back to the point I've made already, that the European Union Trade Association is, if you like, a benefit which could be withdrawn. And you could call that a sanction. I think that's, I'm in favour of that. I'm not so keen on academic sanctions because I think academic discourse across universities is a good thing. But I think that kind of sanction, yes. And certainly the prohibition on the import of goods from the settlements, but labelled Israeli, that's started and I think it's beginning to have some effect.
But what about things like banks? I mean, it was when people like Barclays got under pressure on South Africa that they began to review their position.
I haven't quite got to that stage yet. But
you think it would be premature to do that?
Yeah, I wouldn't go that far yet.
What's your view?
Well, about my colleague here.
No, I was going to pick up on something Mark said regarding Labour Friends of Palestine. I mean, Labour Friends of Palestine does great work, but I think where it's limited is still... within the two-state solution paradigm. It cannot go beyond what is British policy. So I think sometimes organisations like Labour Friends of Palestine, they need to say what is the fact, what is the reality, which is that two-state solution is most likely dead. And I think we need to kind of go back to even the objective or logical conclusion of the Balfour Declaration itself. I think the Balfour Declaration, if you think about it logically, it saw a binational state. It didn't see a state based on race or an identity which is racially divisive. I don't think the values underpinning the Declaration was that. So a binational state is what is required in Palestine. And we've had nearly six decades of trying to divide Palestine, separate Palestine. Now we have, you know, fragmentations within Palestine politically and also geographically with Bantustans and walls and whatnot. So that kind of division is never going to be the solution for Palestine. And organisations like Labour Friends of Palestine, who have a great weight and leverage within the Labour Party, they need to say, you know, the government policy needs to shift slightly and recognise the facts on the ground, which is that the decades of, you know, two-state paradigm discussion is no longer really valid, and we need to state the facts that we need a binational state.
I don't think you should kill off the two-state solution before it's actually dead.
It's also quite amusing that you began by saying Britain should apologise for declaration. Now you're saying it's the sort of birth pangs of the binational state.
In a sense, it is. The logical conclusion was where Britain fell was in its implementation. The logical conclusion would have been if Britain was still in power. If Britain did not leave its mandate.
Should apologise for implementation, non-implementation, not for the declaration.
Yeah, for its non-implementation and its policies during the mandate, which is that it failed actually within the Balfour to uphold the principles of the Balfour Declaration, the second part anyway, which is to protect the indigenous community and their rights, which is the Palestinian community. So Britain failed on that regard. And there is no written statement saying this is the state there's no written statement saying we want a Jewish state or a Palestinian state. The state that's envisaged here is really a binational state.
Well,
I think on that note,
we'll have to end a binational state. So thank you very much for watching. I'm sure we'll be coming back to this issue many times over the next few months. Thank you.
Thank you.